Hey guys, in a previous video I said that one of the main responsibilities of the Vulkan instance is to expose the physical devices on the system. A physical device basically means any piece of hardware capable of running Vulkan. In most cases, this will probably be either an integrated graphics unit on your CPU or a dedicated graphics card, but it can also be a DSP, an accelerator of some kind, or even an advanced coffee machine. Yep, they sure got some crazy espresso machines down there in Italy. Anyway, the Vulkan API provides a set of functions for enumerating the physical devices and exploring their properties and capabilities. This is important because the next step is to create a logical device, which is a software abstraction of the physical device and will be used for the actual work. But this is for the next video. Today we will learn how to scan these devices and choose one of them, if there is more than one, to be used for rendering. By the way, the fact that Vulkan provides a very straightforward way to enumerate and choose devices is a major improvement over OpenGL, where this is not really a feature of the specification, and if you Google it, you will find various solutions, or should I say workarounds, but it always feels like a hack, so this is refreshing. Alright, so in order to manage the physical devices, I have a new class called Vulkan Physical Devices, and this class has a vector of a physical device structure, which is defined up here, and we also have an index to point to the device that we have selected to be used for rendering. Right now it is initialized to -1, so this is how we know that no device was selected. Now, using a vector here for the devices might seem like a bit of an overkill, but this is more of a conceptual overkill. It's not a real overkill, because the expectation, as we said, is to have probably no more than two elements in this vector. Remember that the standard vector is basically just an array, so this is okay. So for each device, we have a physical device structure, and it contains several elements. First of all, we have the handle, the Vulkan handle of the physical device itself. So this is how we identify the device whenever we want to call into Vulkan to get something from it or to create something related to the device. Then we have the physical device properties, which is a structure in itself. We have the version of the API, which is the highest version of the API that this device, this physical device supports. And we also have a driver version, a vendor ID, device ID. And we also have the device type, which tells us whether this is an integrated GPU, discrete, virtual CPU, if this is a software device, like a software rasterizer, and other. We have the device name, which is simply the product name or the way that it is known to the consumer, as well as the limits of the device. This structure contains a lot of minimum and maximum values to everything regarding what the device can do. We're not going to get into this right now, but it will probably be useful at some point. Now notice that some of these attributes are actually vectors, so for each device there may be a different number of elements here. So for example, the Q family properties, we're going to talk about Qs later on. We have a vector of the format supported by the surface, surface capabilities, memory properties. We're going to talk about each one independently. Now this class provides three public functions. First of all, we have a method to initialize our vector of devices, and this function needs the Vulkan instance as well as the surface handle, which we have created in the previous video. After the class has been initialized, we need to choose one of the devices, if there is more than one. Also, if there is only one, we still need to make sure that it supports our requirements. So we have a function called selectDevice, which takes the required queue type and whether this device supports presenting. Now, this function implements a very simple algorithm for choosing the device. You can also choose the device based on its number of queues or the size of the memory, as well as present all the devices to the user and let them choose this from a GUI or whatever. So you have a lot of options here. And after the device was selected, this function will update the dev index, which is the index to the selected device. And then you can call selected in order to return the physical device that you're going to use in this application or in this session. So in this implementation, we are not even exposing the entire vector to the user, just the selected device. Let's jump to the implementation of the class in a new file called device.cpp. And the first thing that we do in this function is to call enumerate physical devices twice. The first time we call it, we provide the instance, the address of the number of devices variable, and null at the end. And what this does is simply to return the number of devices on the system. Because we have a null at the end, it does not return the actual devices, just their number. And this allows us to resize our devices vector for the number of devices on the system. And what this function is actually supposed to do is to return all the handles of the physical devices. And for that, we need to prepare a second vector just for the handles of the physical devices. Because this function will take the address of this array, it cannot work on this structure where the physical devices handles are separated in memory by a bunch of other stuff. So we have to provide a vector just for the handles, and as you can see, this is on the stack. And we resize it in the same way. Now when we call enumerate physical devices for the second time, again, the address of num devices and also the address of this vector. The rest of this function is a pretty big for loop over the number of devices. First of all, we want to extract the handle of the current physical device and save it in our structure. Next, we want to get the properties of this physical device by calling getPhysicalDeviceProperties. And this function takes the handle of this device and the address of the device property structure inside the physical device structure, okay, this guy. We can now print the name of the device, right? We have the device name inside the device properties. And we also print the API version. The next function call brings us to the topic of queues in Vulkan. In OpenGL, we are used to calling one of the GL draw functions, and this triggers the entire machine into action. This is not the way that Vulkan works. Instead, we need to create a command buffer, fill it with draw instructions, and submit it into a queue. The way that we should think about queues is that they are a component of the physical device which actually performs the work. Each device has at least one queue, and often more than one. The queues are grouped into families, and the idea behind the queue family is that all the queues that belong to it share the same characteristics. So they have the same capabilities, the same performance, and etc. This is not something that we can change. The hardware vendor will use queue families in order to organize the resources of the GPU and expose them in a way so that the developer can tailor the behavior of the application specifically to this GPU. Okay, so queues are a big topic and they've got all kinds of craziness going on there. We will get back to them in good time. For now, we just need to understand how many queues and queue families we have on our system and what main features they have. Since each device may support multiple queue families, we do the same trick of calling getPhysicalDeviceQueueFamilyProperties twice. Again, the first time we just provide the physical handle of the device, an address of the number of queue families, and null at the end, which is where the actual information goes in the second call. But before we do that, we need to resize the vector of the queue family properties for the number of queue families, and also a vector that tells us for each queue family whether it supports presenting. And now we can call this function again and provide the address of the queue family properties vector. We can now go over the number of queue families and extract the properties of each queue family from this vector. For each family, this structure provides some bit mask, as well as the number of queues in this family. Now this bit mask tells us whether this queue family supports graphics, compute, transfer, and a bunch of other capabilities. As you can see, I extracted this bit mask here, and I check and print the results of some of those bits. Remember that for each queue family, we also have an element in this vector, queue supports present, which is a vector of booleans. So for each family, we have to call get physical device surface support KHR, and this function takes the handle of the physical device, the index of the Q family from the for loop, the surface handle, which is why we said we need to provide it to the function as a parameter. And then we provide the address of the corresponding location in this vector to get the result. So now we can tell whether this specific Q family supports present on this surface. Next, we want to get all the surface formats that are supported by the current physical device. A surface format is a combination of a format and a color space. The format tells you how the bits are actually encoded for each pixel. For example, we may have just a single red channel of 8 bits encoded as an unsigned normalized value, or an unsigned integer, or a signed integer. And we may have more channels, like red and green, or red, green, and blue. As you can see, there are a ton of formats available, and if you are familiar with OpenGL, then you are also familiar with this format insanity. We also have a color space with a few options such as sRGB and a bunch of other stuff. So in our physical device structure, we have a vector of the surface formats. To populate it, we need to call get physical device surface formats KHR twice. Again, same as before, provide the address of the number of formats variable and the address of the vector in the second call. Between these two calls, we of course need to resize the surface formats vector for the number of formats. We have a small loop here to print the format and the color space, but nothing fancy. Next, we want to get the capabilities of the surface. So this function takes the handle of the physical device, the surface, and an address of the capability structure. This structure provides important information such as the minimum and maximum images that this surface supports on the current device, as well as the current extent, which is the width and height of the surface. There is also a minimum and maximum for that. And we have a supported usage flags, which tells us whether this surface can be used as a source or destination of transferring information, basically copying of data, as a color attachment, same as a frame buffer in OpenGL, depth, stencil, and everything else. So I have a function here which takes the usage flags from the surface capabilities and prints some of the information from it. Next up, we have the presentation modes. Very briefly on this topic, because we're going to go into more details when we get to the swap chain. In OpenGL, we usually create a double buffer setup. Render into one buffer while the other one is presented on the display, and call glfw swap buffers to switch between them when you finish the render function. Vulkan provides more options here in the form of a presentation mode. As you can see, we have no less than 6 of them. One mode, the FIFO, first in, first out, is roughly equivalent to the OpenGL behavior. More on this in the near future. For now, we just want to get the available presentation modes of the surface on the current physical device. Same as before, get the number of presentation modes, resize the vector accordingly, and get the actual presentation modes by calling get physical device surface present modes KHR for the second time and provide the address of the vector at the end. The final thing in the for loop is to get the physical device memory properties. Now, very briefly, because we're going to talk about this in much more details later on, we have an array of memory types and memory heaps in this structure. And for each array, we have the number of elements in the array, right? Memory type count and memory heap count. The memory type has a memory property flag, which tells us whether the memory is local to the device, whether it is visible to the host, and etc. We also have an index into the heap array, which is here. For each heap, we get the size and also a bunch of flags. We can now run this. And as you can see, I have two devices on my system. I have an NVIDIA GTX 1650 and also integrated graphics by Intel on my Core i9 CPU. we can see that the discrete card has four family queues, while the integrated one has just two, and we have the number of queues in each family. We can see that only the first family supports graphics, so the other families can be used for transferring data, and this one also supports compute. So I'm not going to go over everything here. You should run this on your system and investigate the capabilities of your physical devices. So after the class has been initialized, we want to select one of the devices for rendering. For that, we provide the queue flags and an indicator whether this device should support presenting, which is probably true in most cases, but I wanted to keep this function kind of generic. Just a reminder, the queue flags tells us whether the queue supports graphics, compute, transfer, etc. So given these two requirements, we go over all the devices, and for each device, we go over all the queue families. We extract the properties of this family, and we check whether the required queue type bit is set in the queue flags bit mask, because the queue may support more than just one type. Okay, so this is why this is a bit mask. And we also check whether this queue family supports or does not support presenting as requested. Now, if both of these requirements are satisfied, we can save the index of the current device for later, and we return the queue family to the caller. If we get here, this means that the requirements have not been satisfied, and then of course we exit as always. Finally, the selected function returns the device that has been selected. Just make sure that this function was called before that. Back in our Vulkan Core class, I've added the Vulkan physical devices here as an attribute, and also the queue family on the selected device. So we can now initialize the physical devices using the instance and the surface handle, which was created here, and choose one of the devices. Of course, we want graphics. Of course, we want presenting. And then we get the queue family back. And that's it for today. In the next video, we will create a logical device. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.